So now coming to HR and recruitment services, a little about the history about this service of ours. It was created in 2012, so it's about 8 years ago, and it was created at the initiative of the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Development. So at the very outset, the government in France decided to create this service with the intent of helping French nationals to get internships and job opportunities in India. But later on, we really realized that, you know, there was a lot of value that we could add, you know, by kind of offering the service not only to individuals, but also, you know, engaging with companies, helping them to hire quality talent in India. Now, coming to our database, I think this is what really sets us apart from just, you know, any other recruitment consultant or any other, you know, hiring a partner. So we have a very exclusive database. Our database is essentially comprising of Indian student candidates like yourselves, many of you who speak the French language. We also have, you know, a very good database of alumni, that is Indians who've gone to France and studied in some of the leading schools out there. And then also, of course, French nationals, and then bicultural profiles. So bicultural could be Indians who, you know, have maybe got a spouse who's French and then, you know, they kind of get French citizenship. Or it could be the other way around, where you have, you know, a French person of Indian origin or having a spouse who's Indian. So this is our about 70% of this database, which is over here indicated as about 4,000 profiles. But I think another important point that I'd like to highlight is that in addition to candidates who have something to do with France, we also have a lot of candidates and in our database who do not have that connection with France, for the simple reason that today many companies, even French companies in India, are looking for people who are professionals, who have technical expertise, and they're really looking at a particular skill set. So, you know, language or the fact that you've not studied in France is not so much of a criteria in those cases. So, in, you know, keeping that in mind, we have a pretty diverse database, but of course, we are more oriented towards the connection, you know, with France. And other statistics, of course, I will share with you all going forward. But coming to the activities, recruitment assistance is the core activity, which I've already shared a little bit on. We also provide HR advisory. So when we say HR advisory, this covers more of, you know, advice to companies regarding the Indian market, what are the salary benchmarks, helping them maybe to set up an employee code of conduct, enabling them to put various compliances and controls in place. And later on, they may, you know, kind of want also assistance to set up a performance management system for their employees. So anything related to advice, which is, you know, related to manpower hiring and management. Trainings and workshops. So trainings and workshops, again, could be in the form of webinars, they're in the form of workshops, and they can also be in the form of corporate trainings, which are customized, you know, based on the need and requirement of the company. So coming to trainings and workshops, so again, over here, if you, you know, kind of access our website and see our page, we've been able to develop this in the last few months quite actively. And the trainings are also very diverse because we partner with professionals, we partner with French schools, and we offer various courses and workshops. You know, they may be relating to topics like skill development, soft skills like negotiation. But then we also went to the other extreme and we had a nice workshop on meditation and mindfulness. So anything and everything that can actually add value and benefit our member companies is, you know, what we are kind of willing to look at. And committees. I already spoke about it, but just to give you all a perspective, the HR and Recruitment Services Department manages two committees. One is the Human Resource Committee, and the other one is the Higher Education Committee. So moving on, I'd now like to touch a little upon Indo-French relations, because if we are able to understand a little about French presence in India, it'll, you know, set the context for the next discussion, which will be on job opportunities. So coming to this slide, I think many of you all are already aware that France is the sixth largest economy in India. They're second largest in Europe. And in India specifically, today we have about 1,000 French establishments and they are employing around 3 lakh people. So I think that's a very important statistic. And more importantly, I think France is also the 9th largest foreign investor in India. And I think over the last few years, we've seen that French presence in India, or rather Indo-French ties, trade and economic relationships, has only increased. And I think we are likely to see it further develop in the coming years. So moving on, there are many French groups in India. They are present across sectors, across industries. And some of the companies, I mean, I think the logos and the names will be something that you can all connect with. So across sectors, you know, right from Michelin, looking at aerospace, defense, looking at Air France, Alstom, banking, BNP Paribas, Societe Generale, Dassault Systems, Capgemini, I think many of you all would be familiar with Airbus. So you have all sectors. You have luxury, you have Chanel, energy, so automation. So it's across the board. I think this slide would pretty much sum up, you know, the presence across various sectors. So let's move forward. Now let's try and understand what are the job prospects for students learning French. I mean, I believe this would be something you all would be really interested in. So let's try and understand that if you've learned French, then what are the various jobs that are available to you? So this slide is actually essentially highlighting to you the roles, or rather the job functions that come. And all these jobs which have been highlighted here are the ones which we have actually been able to place candidates with companies. So it's not just, you know, the standard job titles, but we've been doing hiring for these various positions. So I'll just run you through a few of them. I think the first thing that comes would anyway, which you all would be aware of also, would be interpreter and translation, because, you know, that's something you develop once you learn the language and you further specialize in this area, of course. There are companies looking at trade advisors who speak in French. They're looking at business development managers, marketing and sales profiles, again, with exposure to French language. And this largely happens with those companies, French companies in India who, you know, have their French clients, but also a lot of Indian companies who do business with France. But another important thing is that, you know, the French language is not only going to be useful for these companies who are, you know, French companies, because we know that French is a great demand and it's used in countries like Canada and large parts of Africa also. So I think, you know, the horizon and the opportunities for jobs is really immense if you look at it from that perspective. Then let's go to human resource professionals, finance professionals, consultants, business analysts, executive assistants who work very closely with, you know, the CEOs and MDs, and French companies, of course, sometimes are very, very keen to have a French speaking executive assistant. Then supply chain experts, IT professionals. And another area, I think, where there's been a lot of demand is for French speaking engineers. And that comes largely from, you know, automotive companies. It comes from companies in aerospace sector, like if you have Airbus and you have Safran and these companies, that's, you know, where they can really see a value at. And again, an operations manager also could be, you know, a profile where French is needed in some companies. So, you know, to sum it all, while, you know, we've highlighted few of these roles with which are there, I've also mentioned below, you know, in asterisks, French companies are always looking for people with French language skills, as it's really a valuable asset for any job profile. So I think any role in any company, if it is kind of clubbed with the French, and if there is a requirement, you know, by virtue of the company being French or because of business requirements, it really becomes an advantage. Now, I've also kind of highlighted some few brands over here or companies just to let you all know that these are some of the companies which with whom we work with for these positions. So Societe Generale, I think more so I refer to the Global Solution Center, which is like their knowledge processing center, which is kind of based in South India and kind of works for the rest of, you know, the group. Then we have Legrand, we have Sopra Steria, Club Med, Hermes, Capgemini, which you all are all familiar with. So we'll move on now. So these are the industries. So I think when you looked at the brands, you pretty much got an idea on, you know, the industries and sectors. But I think this slide further reiterates, and these are again sectors and industries that HR and recruitment services of IFKI has worked with. So we get a lot of requirements from travel, tourism, hospitality, banking, finance, legal consulting, human resource and global mobility, IT and the IT-enabled services and telecom, agro, food and beverage, engineering, like I already mentioned to you, retail, e-commerce. And I think what has really picked up in the last few years has been the demand for, you know, French language resources in the space of luxury and retail. So that's another key area, you know, in which skills can be developed. Government and education institutions always, you know, there is some need. Then energy, oil, gas, infrastructure, aerospace, defense, automotive, pharma, and beauty. So moving on, now I'm just sharing some statistics with you. And the reason to share these statistics with you all is to kind of bring forth again and highlight the potential for job opportunities for those of you who are learning French. So this covers, the statistics and the graphs cover a period of 3 years from 2017 to 18 and 19. And so the chamber has been receiving close to, I would say on an average 70 to 75 job offers. Last year, in fact, we received about 100 job opportunities. And this is a mix of, you know, between French and Indian companies. So I'd say it could be around 50% or it could kind of, you know, shift a little bit sometimes. Placements, again, on an average, we do about 60 to 70 placements a year. In fact, last year was around 75. And if you're looking at which are the cities we've been able to place candidates, Mumbai, of course, accounts for a significant number, which is nearly 43% as per the statistics and placements of last year. Delhi and North India, 28%. And if I add up all of South India, it would be, you know, more or less similar to Delhi. So till last year, we were not really doing much in South India, but I think it's been quite interesting to know that the chamber has been able to, you know, develop the activity pretty much across the cities. So we do have a pan-India presence and we're able to cater to all requirements. Okay, so now this slide is more in the context of Indo-French Chamber and what is it that we can do to assist you all who are learning French. So, you know, I think there's one point I'd like to add that if you really look at, you know, various countries and you see what are the initiatives that are put in place, no doubt every country has a different mandate and they, you know, take a lot of efforts to support people who, you know, learn languages, etc. But I think if you will kind of look closely, you'll see that France as a country has taken a lot of interest and effort to ensure and put into place a lot of support systems so that not only do, you know, French nationals have access to, you know, somebody in various countries or even in our case in India to be able to help them with jobs and internships, but also Indians who can be assisted, you know, via the platform and via, you know, the HR and recruitment services of the chamber. So coming to this aspect, I'd like to share with you all that how we can help you students who, you know, kind of learn French and then are exploring and looking at various job opportunities. To start with, recruitment, I have already discussed. So, you know, we would encourage you all that whenever you all are looking for an internship or job, please feel free to reach out to us, register your CV with the Indo-French Chamber. Secondly, we have something called a newsletter, which is called Recruit Talon. And this is a quarterly newsletter. So what we really do is that, you know, sometimes, you know, we will not get requirements across all sectors for jobs, but we keep getting CVs. So on a day, on a particular day, at least we'll get an average 10 CVs. So we thought, how is it that we can help, you know, the students, the candidates? So what we decided was that we'll come out with a quarterly newsletter. And every quarter we present this dossier, which has about 25 to 30 CVs. Now these CVs will be placed in a template and they're kind of masked. So they are like in an anonymous format, but this entire dossier is getting sent to HR heads of our member companies and also to senior level management. So what happens, it works in the other way, that they may not be an opening, but when they look at a profile and they see, okay, there is a profile who speaks French, who has worked in, studied in France, or who's got international exposure and has certain skills, they may actually find the need to connect with the candidate. And then in that case, they get back to us and then we kind of organize an interview with the candidate and the company. Then we also have Bonjour Talon. So Bonjour Talon, in fact, is our job fair. And we first started off with this initiative in 2018. And since then, we've decided it's going to be like a once in 2 years event. It is scheduled for this year. And most likely, we will have it sometime, maybe around the end of the year, because everything depends upon the current situation. But it's going to be a virtual event this year. So, of course, when we have this event, we will be in touch with Alliance Francaise Pune also to keep them highlighted so that they can communicate to their students who are looking for jobs to register for this job fair. Then we have workshops and training. So over here now I'm talking about workshops and trainings that can assist the students and candidates. So I think in this context, CV writing workshops, how you can, you know, polish your skills to go for an interview, adapting to intercultural work environments, communication skills, networking skills, soft skill development. I think that is something we organize from time to time. And that also helps candidates, you know, to align themselves, especially if they want to work in an Indo-French business community. And then coming to alumni networking events. So we do a lot of events for alumni, students who've gone to France, who've come back, And as I told you, the chamber organizes a lot of events. So, you know, there's always an opportunity to also invite our students and prospective candidates for these events. So moving on, how can you connect with us? So of course, my coordinates and the rest would be available at Alliance Française of the team and the chamber. But in addition to that, like I said, we urge you to reach out to us. Please share your CV with us on employment.service@ifcci.org.in. That is highlighted below on the screen. And of course, we have our page on our website, which you will be able to find. We post all open job offers on our website. So, you know, you can get at a glance an idea on, you know, openings that are available. On Facebook and on LinkedIn, we've created an exclusive group. It's called Indo French Jobs. And this group is only open to people who have some connection with France. So if you are studying at Alliance Française and or you've kind of studied in France or you're working with a French company, you would be a part of this group. And again, this group would have, you know, information from time to time on various activities, initiatives, trainings, programs, and of course, jobs. Whenever jobs are posted, they'll also get posted on these groups. So moving on, we have a small team. So the team is headed by me. I have one colleague, Neha. She's based out of Bangalore. And I have another colleague, Bhakti. She's based with me in Mumbai. But like I said, we have offices on all the four centers. And for HR and recruitment, we work on a pan-India basis. So I've also kind of indicated over here some communication links to the chamber. But I think if you simply go on the web and Google us, you should be able to get all the information that you need. So that is it from me in terms of a presentation, and I will pass it over to Shreya to take it forward now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sapna. I think this was extremely comprehensive enough, and I'm sure there are questions by our participants. And before moving that, on behalf of Alliance Française, we have certain questions. Sure. So especially of late, you know, we have started posting certain job openings, you know, on our Insta, on our Facebook, or on our LinkedIn profile. So when a person or when our students see a job opening, the first thing it comes to their mind is how to prepare a CV. So do you have some tips to share?
I think that's a really nice question, Shreya. So I think it would be very useful for me to maybe add some inputs. So I think I'd like to say that I'm just sharing with y'all things that I feel I've been able to, you know, kind of gather over the years looking at CVs, because like I said, we get about 8 to 10 CVs a day. So over the years, we've been looking at a lot of CVs. And based on, you know, my inputs, I'd like to share a few things. So I think my personal guidance or suggestion would be, first of all, make sure that your CV is always simple and crisp. And I mean very simple in terms of format, in terms of content, in terms of layout. So, you know, really use very simple fonts. Please ensure that you do not have very long CVs, because, you know, earlier, I mean, we are very used to in India also seeing CVs that run into pages. I would suggest, especially for you all, you all are students, and many of you all, you know, are starting out in your career. So I would suggest a one pager is perfect. And I think even for people who have experience, do try and keep it condensed. Do try and keep it, you know, 1 to 2 pages, because, you know, it's very difficult for an employer or any other person to try and, you know, hold their attention for a really long time. So I think that's just a very basic kind of advice that I'm giving you to start with. Now, moving on, I always feel that, you know, in your CV, when you put down your name, below that, you know, you can just mention 2 to 3 lines as a brief summary of your profile. Because when there's an interviewer or an employer who looks at it, at a glance, they can say, you know, like where you come from, what is your skill set. So a very, very brief summary. And then a photograph is essential, in the sense you need to, of course, use your judgment sometimes depending upon the job and the sector you're applying to. But a photograph always helps. So in addition to that, I'd also say that please mention complete personal details, you know, because sometimes we receive CVs and you'll find that, you know, there are your current location is missing or a contact ID is missing. So in that case, if an employer wants to reach out to you, it's, you know, you actually may just lose the chance of getting contacted just because, you know, you didn't have all the details present. So personal details, very, very important on your CV. Then moving on, I'd like to say education details should be in bullet point, very brief. And again, please start with, you know, last graduation or whatever master's or whatever degree you had, go to your employment history. And even in employment history, please start with your current job. Very, very important. And in that current job, when you mention which company you're working from, dates are very important. From and to dates. In case you've left the job, please mention the end date of that job. It's very, very important because, you know, it kind of creates a transparency in the profile. And, you know, you could communicating a very clear picture to the person who's, you know, reading your CV. So moving on from there, I think we can also add on other things into our CV. We can have achievements. We can have personal and professional achievements. It's important for you to mention your skills that adds value, soft skills, hard skills. Then we can go on to mention language skills. So I think for you all, very, very essential that if you're learning French language, please highlight it in your CV. It's really important. So that's something you can add. Interests and hobbies can be added. Now, you know, coming to references earlier, you know, we used to put a lot of references in CVs, but I think I've been noticing that the trend has changed because when does a company need your references? Usually at a later stage when you're shortlisted and, you know, they want to make you an offer. And anyway, we are struggling to put content on CV and say, I have to condense it in one page in two pages. So we can avoid the references in the initial stage and we can kind of leave that out. So that's fine. And I think more importantly, please check your CV for errors. Grammatical errors and spelling errors. I think that's very, very critical because, you know, that first impression is your CV. And if there are errors in this area, then, you know, it's kind of showing to the employer there are issues with communication, there are issues with language and expression, and we don't want that. So do that. And I think lastly, I'll suggest to you all, please ensure that your CV is in a PDF format. Don't send the Word formats. And also, please do not share any Google Doc links. Because sometimes we get a lot of CVs which are, you know, shared links. Please do not make it easier for the person who's reading your CV. Keep it less complicated because links sometimes don't even work, you know, from that perspective. So keep it simple. Use PDF formats. And I think I've pretty much summarized from my perspective. But in case I've missed out on anything, and Shreya, that comes to your mind, please feel free to add.
No, it's interesting. In fact, you meticulously covered all the points. And I'm sure now students will, you know, draft their CVs as per your guidance, given your expertise in this domain. So saying that, you know, that's the first step. And next step is the interview process. How would you suggest to gear up for an interview process? Because is there a cultural, intercultural nuance, like a, you know, French person conducting an interview? What are the questions? How are they differently asked? Can you elaborate on that?
Okay, so Shreya, what I'll do is maybe I think I'll answer this in two parts. So maybe first I can suggest that, you know, what are the few tips that are important? And then after that, I'll just highlight that if, you know, you're going to a French company or you're going to be interviewed by a French employer, what is it that you can kind of keep in mind? So see, I think personally, important that if you're going for an interview, first, please read the job description. Very, very important. Thoroughly read the job description because, you know, when you've read the job description and you're being interviewed, you know, you won't ask questions which are already, the answers are already in the JD. So that's very important because it's not going to give a good impression otherwise. Secondly, try and understand for yourself, you know, why is it that I want to apply for this job? What is it that I can bring to this job? What is the value I bring to this role and to the company? What are my strengths? And what is it that is interesting me, you know, more than anything? So if you're clear in your mind about these aspects, then when you're going to be asked this question by your employer, which you are going to be asked in one form or the other, you'll be really prepared and I think more so clear in your mind. So you'll be able to communicate that effectively and you'll be able to reinforce the fact, you know, that you're really interested in this job. So I think that's very, very important. Secondly, please go to the company website. Try and understand from the company website, what is the background of the company? What are the core activities? What is the company's presence? Where are they based out of? Do a little bit of search on news items. You know, what's really in the news? Because sometimes there are employers who will ask you, you know, so this has been in the public domain or we've had a kind of a acquisition, a growth or a new partner. So what are your impressions about it? So you need to do this little bit of research. And if you are able to know who's going to be your interviewer, you can also do a little bit of profile check on the interviewer because that also helps you to adapt a little bit. Is it an Indian who's going to be interviewing you? Is this round going to be with HR heads or is it a French CEO or, you know, manager who's going to interview you. So that really helps. So do that kind of research, because I think that's, you know, kind of very important. Also social media, they will have various sites. So kind of do that, because that kind of gives you an idea. Then I think coming to the other aspects on, you know, preparing for an interview. I think when you're going for the interview, and you have to focus a lot also on your communication skills. How is it that I'm presenting myself? Be very clear in what you speak. I think also it's important to develop that habit, especially when you're in interview sometimes, because, you know, we are nervous. We kind of tend to get into a mode where we end up talking a lot when, you know, we should maybe not. So I think very important, keep your answers to the point, and also make sure you are listening to the interviewer. Give ample time to be able to listen to the interviewer, speak slowly, clearly. And I think another important point which I'd like to say, please be very honest in these interviews. Because, you know, if there is any piece of information that is not shared at the first stage, and then later on it becomes very difficult. So you don't want to kind of ruin your chances, you know. So please be very honest. Like, if you know you're not working currently and you've just left a company, or you put in your papers, please be very honest. And another thing that actually comes to my mind is that on the salary part, remember that this is the first interview. It's just being conducted to see, should we shortlist this candidate? Is it worth, you know, kind of taking forward? At this stage, you may be asked your expectations. So please stick to just expectations, in the sense, maybe you can pre-plan it and know in your mind what you're expecting. Try to stay within, you know, what market trends are and what is in the industry. No need to get into specifics or get into any figures, because that stage you will have an opportunity later. So ideally, what I'm trying to say, don't put yourself in a situation where, you know, what you say becomes a deal breaker later on. So, you know, you can definitely express your the range you're looking at and what you want, and you can, you know, have negotiations later. So the first interview is not necessary for that, but unless the employers really liked your profile and they get into that discussion, then obviously, you know, you need to kind of use your wisdom at that time to be able to, you know, kind of take it forward. So I think broadly, this is important. And I think in terms of how you go for the interview, in terms of dressing up, I think it's really important to play safe and be formally dressed for an interview. I think, you know, even not smart casuals, be formally dressed. That first impression is most definitely the last impression. So I think, be careful on that side. So Shreya, coming to the second question on interviews with French companies. See, you know, there is definitely a different way in which French and Indians interact or think on various aspects. So I think one thing that, you know, we have noticed when we do a lot of these Indo-French workshops, or, you know, we look at intercultural aspects, you know, sometimes Indians are not very decisive even in their responses. Or, you know, it may be yes or no. And not that, you know, they are not decisive, but it may come across as indecisive. But French, in fact, are very clear, and it's always a yes or no for them. So, you know, that scope of gray area is very less, I feel. So when you're talking and you're being asked a question again, I think be very clear, be to the point. Be very honest about what you can do, what you cannot do. If there are questions also relating to timelines, you have to be honest about it. So I think that is very important, not only at an interview stage, but also becomes very critical when you're working, I think, with a French employer. Clarity in communication. Secondly, when even we learn French and we speak French and we begin to start, you know, speaking with French people, we also take time, you know, to be able to adjust, because sometimes we speak very fast in our own language. So we need to be also careful that if you're speaking English, then, and you're speaking to French, because most of them in India speak English very, very well. But it's important to, you know, kind of, like I said, keep that pace, or that, you know, be slow, you know, communicate effectively so that, you know, you're clearly heard. And that part can also be, you know, addressed properly. And of course, if you're talking to somebody and you're in an interview and you do not understand anything, please be honest enough to ask, you know, to explain. I think that's very, very important. So I think there are certain nuances, most definitely, you know, when you're kind of dealing with this intercultural aspect. But I think most importantly, the, you know, thing that comes to my mind is being very clear and, you know, being honest about the situation. And I think conveying your situation as it is. I think if you can do that, that pretty much addresses everything. Because I don't think a French employer is anything more demanding than, you know, an Indian employer. So there's not anything too much more different from what I already shared.
Okay, great to know these two processes. Now, coming to these companies that you recruit for,
yeah,
what kind of skill set, you know, they ask for? for example, skill set, that means I'm focusing on soft skills,
yes,
and hard skills both, because it's essential for our students to know so that they can concentrate on it. Okay. So,
yeah. So I think in terms of soft skills, see, soft skills are more related, you know, to personal attributes that enabled you to, you know, kind of be good in your job, be successful in your job. So, you know, your ability to communicate, your networking skills, ability to negotiate, being a team player, being flexible, adaptable. I'm just kind of, you know, highlighting a few. And I think the ability to, you know, the conflict resolution, etc., those are all soft skills, you know, and that's important. And there'll be a lot of it which, you know, you'll kind of be good at. And there are a lot which you will be able to develop in the course of your job. So I think that's also very important to know. You know, it's not that you're going to be endowed with all the skills. Everything comes with also working and, you know, as you progress in your career. So those skills are important. But if you're asking me what are really companies looking at, they're looking at team players. They're looking at people who are flexible, who are adaptable, who are not coming with a rigid mindset, who can adapt. Because, you know, in business, you have to have that mindset to be able to change, to be flexible. There may be changes later on which will happen in your role. So you have to be very open-minded. Clarity in communication, I think, is important. So I think these, some of these are extremely, you know, kind of important from that perspective. Now, when you come to hard skills, I think, you know, they are more of the technical skills. But I would say that if you'll have learned French, then please try and use, you know, the opportunity to also specialize in some area. So, you know, you're only going to, otherwise you will restrict the job opportunities available to you. So if you graduated and you've kind of done your French, no doubt, you know, you can get jobs and then you'll grow into those roles. But if you specialize, you know, be it in computer science, be it in masters in management, marketing, finance, supply chain, you're actually enhancing that value of, you know, your own profile. So I think very, very important to develop those technical skills, you know, which can be really, you know, a higher education skills also. And then I think there are other technical skills which are very, very important, you know, which could be analytical skills, project management, and the fact that you're learning a language. In fact, you know, language is also that hard skill, which is so important, you know. So I think it's really, really important to be able to look at soft skills and hard skills and try and work on them. I think we all grow. As we work, we learn. But if you're able to identify those areas that you can, you know, further polish, I think it will really add value to, you know, working in even in any job. I wouldn't restrict it to, you know, Indo-French jobs.
Correct. So I really liked what 2 points you highlighted, and especially for all these students to know that, you know, yes, they don't have to be really complacent with the skills that they have once they land a job. They right. have to always evolve, you know, by learning new things, you know, and eventually they'll climb the professional ladder. Second thing, which is also very important, that along with French is always an asset, but you should also hone your other communication, digital marketing or computer science, where there is a lot of demand and where our students are not aware, to explore and to be absorbed by all these French companies or all the small, medium-sized French companies who are actually looking for such candidates. So I think this is something which will help them to decide judiciously where they want to go. So coming back to again to the next question, do you recruit interns in IFKI, which I know very well, yes. So we want to know that across India, are they recruited? How frequent do you recruit it? And what is it that you look for? Because I believe most of them are freshers. And our students are also freshers.
Yeah.
So they are possibly, if they know about this, they yes. might apply eventually. Yes. So what is it that you're looking for?
Okay, Shreya. So I think you answered one part of the question. Yes, IFKI does hire interns. We are more than happy to give an opportunity for internship, you know, to students and especially those who are learning French. Now, in terms of where do we hire? Like I said, we have four, our centers are in Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, Chennai. So in all these offices, as and when there is a requirement, we definitely look at hiring interns. As and when and where it's possible, we do give a preference. If we can get an intern who knows French, it's a great plus. And if you really ask me in terms of, you know, the history and who all we've been recruiting, I think for most of the part, it has been interns who, you know, kind of speak French language. Now, within IFKI, all the departments will have requirements from time to time. So whether it's our events department, our business support, or it's even HR and recruitment, we are constantly looking at interns. And because interns are largely, you know, students who are, you know, in the process of either considering higher education, etc., we've also kind of defined the tenure. Ideally, we look at maybe 6 months, but there may be cases where it can be extended, no doubt. But we also could look at a slightly shorter tenure, you know, if we can end up getting a good candidate and where, you know, they cannot kind of continue. But ideally, we prefer 6 months because that's a good enough time that the chamber invests in training them. And I think also the candidate is able to learn, you know, in that period. So I think that's very important. So most definitely we look at interns. And in fact, I think the good part is that whenever we have a requirement for intern, it's Alliance Française that we approach. We make sure that we email our job, our internship opportunities to you all to be able to put on your notice board. So I think definitely all the students who are looking for these opportunities can keep a watch. And as and when the requirement comes, we'd be more than happy to, you know, give you the opportunity provided everything aligns and fits in.
Great. So you are coming to to this question particularly, like most of the students here are fresher. Considering that I'm a student of Alliance Française only, I've just freshly graduated, I've completed B2, and I'm applying for this internship. What are the qualities that you look into me so that I can get this internship? Because I'm sure there must be a lot of competition. You are posting this job opening to all the Alliance Française in India. So I would like to know where do actually I stand my chance.
Okay. So when we look at profiles, and especially, you know, there are freshers, which is the case, because, you know, for internships, it's largely the freshers who are looking for that opportunity to get the experience. I think profiles or other candidates who've, you know, kind of been engaged in some kind of project, short-term activities during the course of their studies, be it involvement in, you know, various forums in their colleges, or for that matter, you know, they've been part of, you know, other French organizations here, and they've been kind of, you know, participating in things like maybe a job fair or any other forums. We look at those profiles because we feel they already have that exposure in terms of working. So over here for freshers, nobody's really looking at the number of years you've worked at, but I think you're really looking at also the enthusiasm and interest of that candidate to, you know, kind of develop themselves and start earlier by already engaging on that front.
Correct.
A CV which has, you know, besides graduation, if you've got activities and you can say, oh, I did this project or I participated in that, that CV would definitely be a winner from the lot. And then coming to the next question, if that CV is saying, okay, I've done my B1 and B2, I think that would be the one which would finally get selected. So I'm also happy to, absolutely. But I'm also happy to share that there have been cases where a particular candidate has not really had too much of, you know, other project activity and experience, but because language skills have been so great, it's been, it's been fine for us to take them on. And I think of course, from the perspective of the candidate, but, you know, Shreya, I'd also like to add, I think on this front, as a chamber also, I think we are also, you know, creating these opportunities and we're giving these opportunities to students. So I don't think we are really judging, you know, them only on the basis of experience, because we realize that, you know, if every job you go for, you ask for an experience, where are you going to make a start? Right. So I think I can really proudly say that on that front, the chamber, that is IFKI, has really given an opportunity to a lot of students who are freshers. And I think especially those who have some, you know, have studied at the Alliance. And I think if you really go ahead and see that they have progressed pretty well also in their career, because even for them, you know, once they move on to get another job, and there are many of these companies who could be the member companies of the chamber, and when they know that they have worked for IFKI, it kind of really opens up the doors for them. So I think candidates, yes, of course, if they have the skills, they are bringing that to the table. But I think also as a chamber, we've been able to, you know, really contribute in terms of even, you know, development of
skills,
candidates and profiles in this respect.
Great. So all the participants who are really enthused, want to really prove themselves and who would like to do multitasking, equally like demanding jobs, here's an opportunity, you know, for you to do internships. So my next question is, I think I will now proceed towards question answers. Because
there are some questions, I think, on the chat.
I will read out the questions to you,
sure.
Sapna,
sure.
And you can actually, answer.
Absolutely.
That would be better.
Absolutely.
Okay. There's one question. I'm an English teacher and I'm learning French language. Okay. Is there any job for teachers in French-speaking countries? Do you provide any campus? If yes, what is the age criteria?
Okay, so I think maybe at this point, I'd like to say that Indo-French Chamber, we are largely looking at job opportunities in India. But if you're seeing, are there any job opportunities for somebody who's, you know, you're an English teacher and you're also learning French, then I think like Francophone countries could definitely be an option for you to consider, be it Canada, France, or any other countries. I think those are certain places you can definitely explore. And Shreya, coming to the third part of the question, would you be able to repeat that?
If yes, what is the age criteria?
For getting a job?
Yes, as a teacher, yeah.
As a teacher, so okay, I don't think at present we've got a few requirements which have come. And I think even for that, there has not been something very too specific, but I think it has been maybe, you know, for teachers also, it could have been even late or 25 plus to around 40 has been pretty much the age band, you know, so not too much of a restriction.
Okay. Our second question is, what qualifications are required to become a translator or an interpreter?
Okay, so I think translator and interpreter, if you're looking at, obviously, I'm assuming it's in relation to English, French, and, you know, the French and English translation, I think it's very, very important. In that case, of course, if you graduated, then that part is fine. But I think it's really very, very important in that case to be able to develop your French to a very high level. Because, see, the companies that are hiring, I've already shared with you all. It could be a Capgemini, it could be any one of the banks. So the expectation level would be very high. So it would definitely be a C1. Of course, Allianz would be able to add more in terms of, you know, the certifications, etc. But it would definitely be a C1 level required also for translations. And I think it could, if there is even like a professional course, etc., it would help, you know, on translations, interpretations. But you need to be able to take that French to that higher level, and you need to really practice, practice, and practice. So the focus is nothing but developing your ability to translate, and the translation is needed in terms of written language skills and also in terms of speaking. So both are very, very important.
Correct. So we have Gayatri who's asking us, what is the scenario of placements in Pune?
So, okay. I think when I shared that graph and I shared Mumbai, it was largely also West India. So we work in terms of West India actively, it is Mumbai and Pune. Now, everything all comes down to also French presence, right? Like I said, so we have a lot of companies in Pune. In fact, we have about 35 to 40 companies who are only members of our chamber, you know, significant groups. And we have, of course, other companies as well. So we do get offers in Pune from time to time. In fact, it's not uncommon. In a year, you'll definitely have some opportunities for Pune that do come up. Even currently, in fact, we are working on some requirement which has come from Pune. But of course, that is of a different category and that is more related to industry and manufacturing. But Pune is very much there in terms of the locations for job opportunities.
So there's a law student who's in second year currently. And plus, he's a B1 student at Allianz.
Excellent.
So he wants to know, how is French beneficial for law students?
Okay, so I think what's interesting that I can share from this perspective is that as a chamber also, we have a lot of law firms who are members of our chamber. And so it's important to know, I think, what would that highlight? That if there are a lot of law firms that are members of our chamber, means actually they work with France, they work with French companies. So what becomes important for these companies is to have what we call a French desk. So law firms and consultancy firms. In fact, these are one, you know, kind of lot of companies for us where we do these kind of hiring. So, you know, you could have bigger names like, you know, like Ernst & Young and other bigger companies which are also in the consulting space. And practically all of them have a French desk, they have a German desk. So, I mean, what better combination for them to have a lawyer who speaks French? Because ideally what most of them do is, because you need people, you know, who understand Indian law. So the lawyers are working in their area, and they, what they do, they hire a business development manager who knows French. So sometimes they'll hire a French national, or they could hire an Indian business development manager who knows French. But what if they can get a lawyer who can speak French? I think it's great for them, because, you know, you're actually, you don't need two resources. You know, you are kind of condensing that and reducing that to one candidate, you know. So excellent. I mean, I would like urge you to kind of further your studies in French, and you can always send your CV to us and register it in our database.
I'm working in a French company as a translator. She would like to know if there are any trade and commerce related courses which are conducted.
Okay, so trade and commerce related courses, it's not something we are doing actively within the chamber, But if there is something that she wants to kind of look at specifically, I mean, please, Samruddhi, please feel free to reach out to me. And if I can help you offline by, you know, kind of sharing with you some contacts of, you know, certain associations that provide, you know, a training and exposure on trade, etc., I'd be happy to do that.
Thank you, Sapna. Sapna, many of them are asking us, what about job opportunities in France? So I could see like 4 or 5 of them asking them, is B2 sufficient? Is C1 sufficient? Okay. So yeah, please help them.
So firstly, okay, like I said, the chamber, we're not actively looking and providing job opportunities in France, but I think I'd like to maybe share some perspective because I think that's what, you know, the students want to know. So if you're asking what is the level that is needed, I think if you have a B1, B2, that's excellent because, you know, if you go to France and you're kind of looking for a job, you'll be able to find your way through. And then as you continue to live there or study there or work there, you'll really polish your language skills. So if you have that already with you, it's a great thing because, you know, to go there and learn, not a bad idea. I would still encourage, you know, to continue to do that. But a B1 is excellent. A C1, I mean, couldn't be anything kind of better than that. Now, if you're looking at job opportunities, I can largely, you know, kind of share with you what has been happening. So if you like maybe randomly say, okay, I know French and I just want to kind of go and work in France, sometimes it's not that easy because as we know that every economy is going to support, you know, jobs in their own country. And there are certain requirements for visa, etc., etc. So I think what we have largely seen is that when you decide to do your higher education in France, which is, I think, something that you can kind of learn more from Campus France, because, you know, we, in fact, whether it's the Chamber, whether it's Alliance, and whether it's Campus France from Institut Francais, we all kind of work together because, you know, it's, we are all promoting, you know, even French education in and language in India. So if you kind of decide to do your higher education in France, and I think then that automatically improves your chances to get a job. And then again, that depends upon sector and industry. So I'm not trying to say that just, kind of studying in France is your guarantee or your passport to getting a job in France, but it's definitely opens up the prospects. You get a chance to do an internship. I think most of the CVs of alumni I see have, they've done internships in France. And then many of them based on their sector have got jobs. Like if you look at engineering schools, you know, sometimes we try to reach out to the French engineering schools over here where Indians have gone and studied in France, because I may have an automotive company and they may say, I want a French speaking mechanical engineer. I would rarely be able to find too many of those engineers over here because there's a great demand for engineers in any case in France. You know, engineering is pretty common in India and we have a lot of people doing it, but engineers are pretty much an area of specialization and they are greatly in demand in France. So for that particular industry and sector, if you're looking at, then if you go and study in France, most of them actually end up getting jobs. Hardly anybody has, you know, kind of come back. So I think that's definitely another way that you can look at. And then, you know, you can never say that many a times you start working and you enter into that Indo-French business community in India, and then you may end up getting some kind of a transfer from India to France. So there can be different ways in which it can happen. So I think the first step is that if you're interested in the French language and the, you know, you're kind of keen to work in this Indo-French space, start somewhere. And that starting somewhere can be where you are also in India, especially if you're not going to pursue higher education. So, you know, you can explore and look at what works for you. And I think it'll be different for each person, you know, the context of their personal lives, I think.
Correct. So we have Parinita asking us, what are the job opportunities for French language B2 level and CA interqualification in Pune?
Okay, so I don't think I can in Pune specifically, because it will depend upon the job opportunity that comes. So if you're asking me, are there many jobs that we get for CA and CAs who kind of know French? There are not too many job offers which will specifically say that it's a CA necessarily with French, but I have seen that when we have been able to provide these profiles to French companies, you always end up getting an edge and being, you know, given a preference. So if you are a CA and you're learning French, it's quite interesting for you to be able to explore opportunities with companies in the Indo-French space, because there is a great demand. You know, you may not necessarily come across a job which says French speaking CA, But a CA who knows French is a definitely it's a value add. And I think like we added earlier also, it's just going to enhance the value of your profile. So we do get a lot of requirements from time to time. So I'm not saying that currently, of course, I don't think we've recently had anything very specific, but we have a lot of finance related jobs. So a CA would obviously, you know, be a valuable resource in that respect. So I'd say great potential. So do continue, you know, pursuing French language studies.
One question is, says, hi, usually the job offers I receive are from call centers, BPOs, which work on shifts, but I have a degree in IT, Information Technology, MBA. So how should I look for jobs?
Okay, so like I said, it's very good to know that you have that specialization in IT. Because see, if you didn't have that specialization in IT, then you would be limited to, you know, the translator and the, you know, roles where, you know, you're the French language resource in a KPO or a BPO. But now that you have this specialization, again, it is very important to focus on these IT kind of IT companies, and you will have to look at companies which are either French IT companies or companies, you know, which are dealing with Francophone countries. I think that's something which is very, very important. So if you are learning French and you're an IT professional, we are happy to receive your CV. That's also a very kind of an interesting profile for us. So do reach out to us, and then the job opportunity will, you know, as and when it comes, we'll reach out to you. You know, sometimes everything is not available at one time, but if it comes up and you're in our database, we can kind of take that forward.
Great. So Mukta is asking us, what are the opportunities of a commerce graduate learning French?
Okay, so like I shared in terms of the jobs, I think if you're a graduate, then, you know, largely translations and the entry level administrative assistant kind of roles, those will come to you easily. But if you really want to further and enhance your, you know, the options that are available to you, then I would really urge you that, you know, start off somewhere. I'm not saying don't start. Please start. But during the course of your work, polish your soft skills and hard skills. You know, try to see that while you're working, you can kind of take up some courses in correspondence and maybe do a master's or do a kind of an MBA or further enhance your soft skills. And then what will happen is you're going to open yourself to a lot more opportunities that are actually available. So if you're a graduate and you speak French, I'm not saying you can't get a job. Definitely you're going to have better prospects than somebody who's maybe just a graduate. But the idea is that today every employer is looking at some candidate that has something that sets them apart from the other. Otherwise, what is the differentiating factor? So don't stop where you are. I would definitely say, please continue to develop your hard skills and other soft skills, like, you know, we shared earlier.
Great. So Niti says, it's quite redundant, but in a different context, she says, I'm in my last year of graduation, BA in psychology, okay, and done with B2. I'm planning to do my master's in French language and do my career in the same. What are the opportunities for me?
I think there will be a lot of opportunities because I've already kind of shared the various job options that are there. So if you're going to do your master's in French language, of course, I'm not only touching up on translation, etc. But if you have other skills, you know, where you get a little bit of experience and you've also done, say, marketing, or you've maybe done business development, then you can get into any role. So the idea is get your French language at that high level of, you know, kind of doing that master's. And then there are a lot of opportunities. There are a lot of opportunities in French institutions. There are a lot of opportunities in French government institutions and a lot of French companies. But then again, you can always start. You can go, you can do your master's, you can come back to India, you can start, you can take up some kind of an opportunity in an area and sector that works for you, and then start growing into those roles from there. So you'll always need a starting point, you know. So there is a lot of potential. If you've done your master's, I would say try and find that area where you can specialize and somewhere where, you know, you can decide that this is where I want to focus on. That's important.
We have an interesting candidate who has, you know, experience of more than 6 years in IT industry.
Yeah.
He says, how is the job market in Francophone countries and how do you help such people?
Okay. So like I said, we don't really work too much with the countries. I mean, it's India is our area of focus. So we're not really working too much with Francophone countries. So ideally, I think if you speak French, yes, there's going to be a demand, but I guess you would kind of need to access some of the other job portals and platforms, you know, to be able to see what jobs are there. I mean, we can maybe give you some basic inputs and, you know, guidances that you may need. But if you're, say, you know, kind of looking that, is there a job offer which will come directly to me? That really does not happen because we are more focused on job opportunities in India, you know, within the Indo-French business community and with other companies as well.
But, you know, there's a girl, Dipti, who is actually going to, shifting to Lyon post-marriage. And she's a CA and she's completed B1 level.
Right.
So, like, we have a chamber here. Would you have such leads there in Lyon so that, you know, maybe
she can apply? I don't know if there is directly, like I'd say, a lead to from that perspective, but there are certain websites, certain portals which can be accessed. So if needed, she can definitely reach out to me, and I can maybe ask her to kind of try and focus on some of those job portals for looking at the opportunities.
Great. Hope this helps you, Dipti. One question which people are asking is that, okay, there is an internship opportunity in IFKI, but apart from IFKI, are there other companies, you know, who are ready to take internships?
Absolutely. Because see, there was a time where there were a lot of French companies who were very keen on getting French interns. Then, you know, there were certain changes that happened in the visa regulations. So, you know, French students who come to India on an exchange, or French students who are doing them studies in France, but who, you know, who are exploring overseas options for internships. So I think over the years, we've seen a decline in French national students coming on internships. So that has actually increased and opened up the opportunity for Indian students. So it does come up from time to time. And I think even more than, internships, I feel are kind of not really so common in terms of companies, but what companies are doing now, they're hiring people on contracts, which are equivalent, I would say. If you take someone on a 6-month internship or you're taking someone on a 6-month contract. So I think there are opportunities, definitely. Short-term contracts have also, there's a great demand. And I think now, we know, with the uncertainty and the slowdown that we're looking at, I think there will be many companies who will tread cautiously. So they will be keen to, you know, kind of explore and give opportunity to freshers and look at shorter term contracts rather than, you know, taking on permanent employees to increase headcount too soon.
So there's one question on salary aspect.
Yes.
Khushbu is asking, what can be the approximate salary range that a candidate with a postgraduate degree in commerce finance and having B2 level of experience expect in a company like Capgemini, Airbus, L'Oreal, so all these large size companies?
See, it depends on a lot of things. It will depend upon the role. It's going to depend upon your number of years of experience. So I don't think it would be fair for me to put any, limit to that, but I can basically share with you that if you're kind of looking at, you're a fresher and you've not got too much of experience and you kind of start, you can definitely look at, and you know French, you can definitely start from at least 50,000, 40 to 50,000 a month is possible. So if you don't know French, I feel those students still start maybe with 30,000 a month. I'm talking about freshers. Now, as you continue to advance, you know, in terms of the number of years of experience you have. So if you've got about 3 to 5 years experience, then we can look at the range of maybe 6 to 8 lakhs per annum. Then if you're looking at something more, the salary range can go higher, but it's very difficult to, you know, quantify very exactly because, you know, the salary you get paid depends upon a lot of things. It depends upon the industry. It depends upon the role, the number of years of experience, and most importantly on your profile. So I just kind of shared with terms of freshers in about 3 to 5 years. And if you're looking at more than that, then, you know, more years of experience, and obviously salary will be commensurate with that. If you studied in France and you come back to India, then again, that's, you know, you can command a premium again. So maybe that person who has about 3 to 5 years experience can also end up getting about 8 to 10 lakhs per annum. So, you know, it's all a function of your profile.
We have one student who says that she's going to start working with Capgemini in marketing role and she has completed B2. Mm-hmm. How can she convert knowing French advantages for her?
So I'm not really too sure if this role is something that requires French or no. So it's a marketing role. I'm assuming it's a regular job, but she kind of knows French. So I think, in situations like this where you've learned French and you've kind of got into a French company, you obviously go and do your best in terms of the role, what you've got. And as you kind of settle down into the company and you get a chance to engage with your employer or you get a chance to engage with human resource, it's very, very important to try and see if you get an opportunity to be able to communicate that you have this language skill and also your interest to be able to do something with that language skill in the company you are in. And I think that would be greatly appreciated because if there is a company and they have you in marketing, you know, everybody grows. You can be in that role maybe for 2 years and 3 years, and tomorrow there could be a requirement in the same company for someone having similar skill set or maybe even a bit different. But because you've already worked in the company, they can be open to training you. So, you know, take up what you're getting, get that entry, do your best at what you've got, and then use every opportunity to be able to convey. And then, you know, many people have companies have what they call IJPs or internal job postings, which are posted and which they are shared. You can always apply for an IJP if it comes up. Or, you know, if you have a performance appraisal and when you're kind of reviewing your activity for the year, don't hesitate to be able to express, because you'll always be asked, you know, what are your aspirations? What is it that you want to do going forward? Always important to express this, because only if you express it will your employer know what you want. And then when an opportunity comes, you can be approached. So do that. Please do that.
So we are moving on to our last question, because yes, we've already crossed our deadline. So one student is asking that, will I be able to get an internship being an undergrad?
Okay, so ideally, you know, even at the chamber, we look at graduates. We look at that as a minimum kind of criteria. But there are some companies who are open to it, especially, you know, if you have your French language skill. But I would urge you that even if it is correspondence or any other means, please do try and complete your graduation, because I think today that is the basic criteria. You'll really limit yourself, you know, and I feel then, you know, getting that job, and even if you get a job, you know, you'll really struggle to get what you feel you really want. And then just because you've not graduated, you may have to some way compromise on, you know, your own potential and take up something which may not really be what you are capable of. So I mean, I know that's a personal decision and it's kind of on another note, but I would definitely urge you that continue to take up an internship, but do see parallelly if you can complete your graduation, because graduation and a French degree, you know, kind of opens up the opportunities on a totally different level. So don't lose out on that.
Great, Sapna. I think we have tried to cover most of the questions, but due to time constraints, we'll have to end. And your feedback was extremely valuable, your suggestions. I hope these students have takeaways. They will now judiciously decide what to do with French, which are the skills, and they know whom to contact in India, basically. So we are lucky to have you, that you started the service for all the French-speaking Indians, especially all the students of Allianz. It really encourages them to, you know, to continue learning French with us. And yes, I will say good evening. And this is for the participants. We shared a Google link. Please share your feedback with us, because if you want us to repeat such sessions, it's important for us to how to fine-tune it and to respond best to your needs and requirements. Thank you very much once again. Peony is in the background, yep, who's technically managing us, who's not visible. Thank you very much to her equally. Thank you, Sapna. Thank you, all the participants. Have a nice evening. Stay at home. Stay safe.
Thank you, Shreya. I'd also like to just thank Allianz Francaise de Pune and Shreya for reaching out to me for this opportunity. Absolute pleasure for me to be part of this session. I really enjoyed it. And please feel free, if there's any way we can guide you, help you, reach out to us. And don't hesitate to share your CV with us. Shreya would be, I think, happy to share our email ID with you. And in any way which we can help you, we'd be happy to do so. So thank you so much. And everybody have a great evening. Great. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.